Hey, everybody, right here at the top of the podcast. If you want to help me out, this is a great way to do it. Go to joematarese.com. Do it right now. There's two affiliate programs at the bottom of the website. What an affiliate program is, it's like a banner. They ask you to put them on your website. If people click on it and get these free memberships, they make me money, actually, just by signing up. They give you 1 month for audible.com for free, and also Amazon Prime will hook you up with a month for free. So you can't beat that. All you have to do, sign up for the free membership, and if you want, you can cancel it. Cancel it like 3 days in. It'll still make me money. Well, and I mean, maybe you don't want to cancel. Amazon Prime is cool. It's great to have. I have it. I use it all the time. I buy everything on Amazon Prime. It's like anything from a doorknob to your house to like a pair of sneakers to a pair of Cole Haan shoes. Just everything. I use Amazon Prime for it. And then like, seems like as soon as I order it, like it's at my front door. It's like getting Chinese food. It's like, how did it get there that fast? That's insane. The other one is for audible.com. If you sign up for audible.com for this month thing that they're doing, you get two free books in that month. And once again, you can cancel it right away if you feel like it. I'll still make some money off of it. That's all I wanted to say. Two affiliate programs right at the bottom of joematarese.com. Hook me up. I think you remember this music, don't you? Pretty great theme. Simple and great. That's what Everybody Loves Raymond really was, wasn't it? It was pretty simple, but great. It reminded you of your life. That's all we're really looking for. It's amazing that they can't do that on TV anymore. I don't know what has happened to sitcom, but it's become let's do a show that nobody can relate to. That's a good idea, huh? How about we do that? I got this perfect idea that nobody will connect with. How about that? No, just make it simple. It doesn't have to be something so elaborate. And my guest today, Phil Rosenthal, I thought just nailed it out of the park with Everybody Loves Raymond. And I've seen him interviewed so many times, and even more in the last week, because I've been just trying to do research. And sometimes as a podcaster, you're like, should I just stop doing this much research? Maybe I know too much. I'm going to have nothing left to ask him that I'm really curious about, because I know everything about this guy now. And when I bought his book, I don't know how many years it's been out. And this is pre-Adderall, so I bought the audiobook. And there's only been a few audiobooks that I've listened to when I'm driving to a gig that's far away. I'll either load up a lot of podcasts, or once in a while, when a comedian's book comes out that seems to be something that I would be interested in, I get it for a long trip. And I remember getting Phil Rosenthal's book called You're Lucky, You're Funny. Basically, I think under that, on the front of the book, it says how to make your life a sitcom. And I just thought, how do I not get that book? I mean, that's been my dream as a comedian for a really long time now. If people say, well, what is your goal? What do you want to do? What is your end thing? What is your dream job? And when I used to teach stand-up for a very short time, for like a year and a half, that was something I would ask each student at the beginning of the class, because if you find that out, it helps you give the guy advice because you know what his end goal is. My goal for a very long time has been to do a sitcom about my life. I got that little taste in the year 2000. If you watch my streaming Facebook video earlier today, showing you the studio that I'm recording in and talking about my guest, Phil Rosenthal, teasing the episode a little bit, you saw a little picture on the wall, that said NBC Burbank visitor pass. It's the basic, I think it's the parking pass or the visitor pass to come into the offices there to pitch a show to NBC that I ended up getting a development deal for. Wrote a script with this guy named Matt Wickline, who created his big show was the Hughleys. Can I pronounce that correctly? D.L. Hughley had a sitcom called the Hughleys. He made a lot of money on that show. D.L. did, and so did Matt Wickline. And I got a little taste of, wow, what if I get a show about my life? Oh, my God. And that just starts. Whew. When you're a young comedian, I was very young. That's 16 years ago. I'm 48. So let's do the math. 38 minus 6. I'm 32, which is, it's a baby, really. Comedians I know now that are 32, I'm like, oh, you just started. It's crazy that I say that. And I started at like 19 or 20. It was 12 years in. But oddly, it wasn't at a level that was high enough to really, I think, pull off my own show back then. There's some guys that have that crazy thing where you go, that guy could pull off a sitcom now. That's rare. But I don't think I had the skill, the knowledge, the life perspective, and the skill as an actor. But I do feel that I'm almost, it's going to sound cocky, I'm overqualified now. I feel like if you gave me a chance to do my own sitcom on TV in 2 episodes, I would have it down. I really feel that. I do, especially if you let me surround myself with amazing actors. That's another thing that I'm sure Phil Rosenthal had something to do with, which I'll ask him about when he's going to, I think he's FaceTime audioing into the podcast. Hopefully it sounds good. But I will definitely ask him about that because he picked pros. I mean, God, I should pull up their names real quick. Okay, found that pretty fast. The list of actors, I mean, they're just so talented, such great slam dunk sitcom actors. And then on top of it, you had Ray Romano doing really his first TV series, who was just incredible. I don't know if people realize it. I think some people are so good at something sometimes that it looks easy and you don't realize how good they are. Does that make me some sort of deep thinker? When I see someone and I go, wow, this guy's so good, it looks like he's not even doing anything. That's how good Ray Romano is in Everybody Loves Raymond. Patricia Heaton, who played his wife, just so great. Brad Garrett was kind of, just a stand-up comedian, 6'10", an impressionist that was, I guess, made a choice
to talk like that. Hey, Raymond. Everybody loves Raymond.
You know, just made some choice and was a standout on the show. But to me, the biggest standout, and Peter Boyle was great. Peter Boyle, unbelievable actor who's been dramatic and comedic. He was in Taxi Driver, unbelievable, and Everybody Loves Raymond. But Doris Roberts was like the Kramer of Everybody Loves Raymond. I couldn't watch that show without just thinking of my mom and my grandma. Every episode I was just like dying. I was like, someone's finally doing it. They're seeing how that ethnic mom is and just hitting it out of the park, like the ball was still going with Doris Roberts. I mean, there was a time my grandmom looked, she's still alive, my grandma, I'm 97, looks just like Doris Roberts, especially when my grandmom was younger, because my grandmom's way older than Doris Roberts, obviously. But Jesus, playing Ray's mom, Marie Barone, oh my God, just so funny, oh my God. And you just go down the list and you look at this, you're like, just even their side actors, you know, like Fred Willard. You had Kevin James was even on a bunch of episodes before Everybody Loves Raymond, right? Or I mean, King of Queens. he was on Ray's show, and it was, people don't realize it. It was like a subtle spinoff, kind of. That's where he got his sitcom legs, they say. Did I say Robert Culp? Chris Elliott's on the list. I mean, God, Chris Elliott's hilarious. Who else is on the list of little side parts, smaller parts? I'm scrolling down. I see someone that I always love is Fred Stoller. He was on 7 episodes. Fred Stoller, if you don't know who he is, go watch Dumb and Dumber. He's the guy in the payphone. I'm trying to use the phone. And the guy just punches him right through the glass and like knocks him out. Fred Stoller used to be a stand-up comedian I loved when I was younger. Who else? Who else is on this list of just unbelievable? Bob Odenkirk here for 2 episodes. God, Brian Posehn, who's a great comedian. Dave Attell, I remember him. Dan Castellaneta, who, do you know who that is? That's the voice of Homer Simpson. I have to do my favorite line from a Simpsons episode. Do you remember the episode of The Simpsons where Michael Jackson did a voice and it was this big, goofy, lumpy looking guy, but he sounded like Michael Jackson? And I think Homer was in prison with him. And he's like, who did you say? Who did you say you were? He's like, Michael Jackson.
Doesn't ring a bell.
He's like, Thriller, Beat It.
When was that last one?
Thriller.
Yeah, still doesn't ring a bell.
I still remember that. Hilarious. Dan Castellaneta. I hope I'm saying it right. Dan Castellaneta. So talented. So funny. Who else is on here? Jesus, I'm really scrolling down. There's just so many people on this list. I want to see the ones that stand out to me. Craig Anton, who I knew from stand-up. He's hilarious. That's who I wanted to say is, why am I forgetting his name? Andy Kindler. That's the one I was trying to think of. Oh my God, Andy Kindler. He was even funny on this show. Like, when comedians are nailing it, that's when you know the show's nailing it. Because stand-up comedians, I mean, let's face it, I think it's rare that they just slide us into sitcoms constantly. I think we have this stigma that we can't act. But we can. If it's a well-written show, we crush it. And this show had a lot of very great writing. So, Phil Rosenthal, my guest, and I'm excited about this one, everybody. I got to be a little nervous. I don't usually get nervous for guests. A little bit nervous just because a little tease there is if they said to me, Joe, you got a sitcom for network television about your life. Who, if you could pick anybody, who would you want to write the show? I say Phil Rosenthal. I don't know. I have this sixth sense. I haven't talked to him ever. This will be the first time I've ever talking to him. I feel like there's going to be a connection. I feel like he's the neurotic Jewish version of the Italian me. Everything that I've seen him on, I usually laugh at. I even saw this Funny or Die video that he did where he did a Jewish version of Bruce Willis in Die Hard. Go check that out. Look it up. It's really funny. I should play that. Let's play that for like a minute, and then we'll start the show. I want to get to the guest. I don't want to be too lengthy at the top here, but just know I'm really excited and a little nervous. Okay, I'm gonna try to relax. Here's that that video of him doing the Jewish Bruce Willis.
It's Christmas Eve in L.A., and within the skyscraper high above the city, a team of super thieves has declared war. Now, with panic setting in, there's just one man who can stop them.
Sure, come out to the coast. We'll have a few laughs. Hurry, my Schwitzy.
Who are you, then?
John. John McCohen. Hello, Mr. Gruber. Are you there? Hello?
Hello?
I wish my nephew Jason was here. He would show me how to work the damn thing.
Do you really think you have a chance against us, Mr. Cowboy?
Yes, I know the odds aren't very good. But, if you remember the story, the oil in the lamp was only supposed to last one night. Lasted 8.
He's the wrong guy, in the wrong place, at the wrong time.
Wait. Shh,
He's not a lover, and he's certainly not a fighter.
We have to do this. I know a very nice coffee shop. If you like it. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Please, here, take this. This is my doctor, Dr. Colonello, a great orthopedic. And tell him I sent you, because I literally sent you.
That's the out. Tell him I sent you, because I literally sent you. All right, we'll be back with with Phil Rosenthal, and also here's a little quick commercial. Okay, folks, you want to come and see me live? I'd really love that. Come out to Miami, Florida. I'm going to be at the Comedy Inn. The Comedy Inn next weekend, believe it or not. That's April 15th and 16th. I think I'm doing 3 shows there. Go to thecomedyinn.com or go to joemaderese.com and you can get all the info for that. All right? Come on out and follow me on Twitter. It's at the Joe Maderese. Facebook, the Joe Maderese. And, you know, follow my YouTube page too. Do all that stuff, okay? And go on the iTunes link when you download these episodes and subscribe and write comments. Those really help my podcast a ton if you write comments on the page and you rate it, okay? All on the iTunes page. All right? All right. That's all I wanted to say. Come and see me live. All my dates, too, are on joemaderese.com. This sounds better than it. This doesn't have a computerized sound. It's actually,
right.
I've never done this before with my computer, but it's showing me like an equalizer version of our voices on the screen. It's pretty high tech. Wow.
How do I look? I hope it's skinny.
That's the best part about is doing these this way. I'm like, I don't have to take a shower. I can like be in my pajamas.
I can smell that through the phone, actually.
I was supposed to have to do the interview with you, and then last minute I got an email this morning that Anthony Cumia is having all these co-hosts, because I guess he went into rehab, and I do his show a lot, and
right.
And they were like, oh, we need a guest. Can you come in? And I'm like, I started right. You know, I got – my kids are a little younger than yours. I have an 8 and a 4-year-old.
Oh, they're much younger.
Yeah.
Mine are, you know, 21 and 18.
Oh, yeah. So
I'm an old guy.
I don't think you're that much older than me. I'm 48.
I'm 56.
Okay, yeah. You just had kids younger. I had kids late.
Yeah.
So, they, you know, you can remember having kids that age where you're like...
Of course.
And it's funny because my wife, you know, it's... I feel like we have a lot in common before I even start talking, but... Or we start talking, is that I'm sure you can remember before your success and being married and how, well, see, your wife's an actress, so maybe it's a little different, because my wife gets to the point where she's like, oh, I'm like, you know, I should go in and do this Anthony Cumia thing because this other guy who's co-hosting has his own show on Comedy Central. That's a good thing. And I'm friends with him, and I wanted to do his podcast. And she goes, you know, I'm just getting, she starts to get sick of that. Maybe this could lead to something.
Of course. But that's like, what else do we have? Everything. We do everything because maybe it'll lead to something.
I know. And I'm like, I'm like, all right, I can figure it out. My brother-in-law can pick up the 4-year-old. And I'm like, I can bring the 8-year-old into New York City and just let him sit on a couch with an iPad for an hour, and we'll shut off the volume because I know it's going to be a really dirty podcast or whatever.
Listen, I'm only nice to my wife because I think it maybe will lead to something.
Yeah. So it's weird. I don't know why. I feel like we know each other. We may have met for a second once in like the Montreal Comedy Festival, because
oh. I like that.
I know somebody who was a writer for Everybody Loves Raymond, who I think you were hanging around with in Montreal one year, and was
who?
Tom Caltabiano.
Yeah, he's a very dear friend of mine.
Yeah. We used to play on the same softball team for one of the comedy clubs in New York City. I guess he moved to L.A., and I don't know if he moved to L.A. for that job.
I think he did.
He probably did. He probably did, and then the rest was history.
Yeah.
Yeah. So so it's the other thing about interviewing you is I've done so much research on you that I feel like I know everything. I did too much.
I'll try to surprise you.
I've done a ton of research, so what happens is, like you said, like I just said, you're like, all right, well, what can I ask him about that everybody else hasn't asked him? I mean, you know, but I know my listeners will enjoy kind of your life story, so we can mix around. And
ooh, are you there?
Yeah.
Hello?
Can you hear me?
Oh, good. I think what happens is if I walk from one room to the other, the Wi-Fi in the different room picks up, and you can sometimes can lose signal.
Oh, okay.
But I think we're good.
Well, you have an acting background, but did you ever do stand-up when you were coming up as an actor?
I tried it once.
I tried it once.
I think I was 19, and I got up at there was a local jazz club in Rockland County, and they had amateur night. And in between trumpet players, sometimes once in a great while, they'd have a comedian. And so I got the balls to get up there. And I put on my little cassette recorder because I heard that's what you do.
Mm-hmm.
I had about 10 minutes that I prepared. And it seemed to go okay. What was not okay for me was the front, like, there was maybe 8 tables in the front, but behind the front with no wall whatsoever was the bar. And the bar was noisy and they were never going to stop talking for anything. They were, and it was a full bar. Uh-huh. And so for the 8 tables right in front of them, that's who you're talking to. I could never get past the distraction, you know, of the talking.
Mm-hmm.
And because I had been in the school plays and stuff where people sit and watch you.
Right.
And I thought, well, this is awful, doing this. And I never wanted to do it again.
Really?
And I know it's different. I know it's – but listen, I think it – for you guys who do stand-up, and I know many stand-ups, I think it's one of the bravest, greatest things you can do. Very few people are great at it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But the ones that are the, you know, these incredible geniuses, I think.
Right.
And brave as hell. Everyone is brave.
Right.
But listen, most things are terrible. So it's not just stand-ups. Well, it's everything and everywhere.
You just described how Fixing Joe actually started. That's how it evolved. That was the first episode, what you just described.
Yeah.
Well, I'm very pro, like, medication, which a lot of comedians are afraid. They're afraid to take meds. What if my craziness makes me funny? You know, whereas.
By the way, have we started? Are we recording?
Oh, yeah, we're recording.
Oh, good. I thought we were just talking. You're so good at this. You just slipped into, we slipped into podcast mode. Very nice.
I wish I was that. Well, maybe you are. I am.
No, it's very natural.
Thank you. Yeah, so basically.
But now I'm going to be totally numb.
Now you'll
be totally
too
different.
On.
Now that I know. It's like when the coyote runs off the cliff and he keeps running until he looks down. That's when he falls.
Yeah, exactly.
That's going to be me. That's going to be me now.
That's what I used to have to explain sometimes to, like, family members when they would hear, like, for instance, one of your comedy albums, or, like, they'll see your half hour or your hour special on TV. Mm-hmm. Like, my wife would say, like, it's good, you know, but I've seen you just be, like, so unbelievable before. And that's just you being good.
Right.
And I had to explain to her, I go, if I can do good with all the cameras running, I'm golden. I said, because I've seen where it's just bad with the cameras on. Like, it's really hard to have the best set of your life that you on Letterman. It's like, it's not, you can have really good, but to have the best set of your life, it's going to usually be at the VFW hall where you're doing a fundraiser. That's just the way it works.
Yeah.
Because you could give a complete shit. You could care less.
So what's the lesson?
Yeah, so
the lesson is...
Don't
care. To be calm.
To be calm.
To be calm. The best actors, they take more training in how to relax than anything else.
Well, that started to happen when I went on the medication that I was afraid to go on for so long. Like people would come up to me after they would see a set where I'd be on TV. They're like, you just look like you didn't care. And I go, this medication makes me. I actually don't. I said, it's really weird.
Because what is it?
I take this medication called Celexa. It's, you know, it's Celexa and Lexapro are almost the same. And I take the lowest amount that it's on. And it's an SSRI. Right. And mine was, I was never a depressed person, but I was an anxious.
Right.
Especially when it was show business. Like, I remember the first Letterman. I mean, just, like, couldn't sleep for, like, a week. You're just up there.
Oh,
like,
I would need a few Celexas if I was going on Letterman.
Yeah. So, to cut back. So, the first episode, which you're talking about, that side noise, that used to be something that I just could not deal with. And then I realized later, once I married a psychologist, oh, you have ADD and you have it really badly. And why don't you try that too? Like, another joke on stage, I almost act out like I'm a pelican, like I'm just taking all these pills that she's offering up, you know?
But don't most people have ADD? Don't you think?
Sure.
I think we all have ADD.
Performers and creative people might, but my wife, who's a woman with a PhD.
But aren't we all easily distracted? Aren't we all like, and the phone just exacerbates this, right? The phone that demands our attention. We're now an entire species that's half human, half phone, and it's because I think everyone is ADD. It's because we are so easily distracted, and because, oh, there's a thing in my pocket that's the whole world is connected to, and people have my text number and they're texting me, and I might miss something, and that might be more important than the person that's right in front of me talking to me right now.
Right. It definitely doesn't help it. No, definitely. It's like,
I think it's the machine was invented because of it, took advantage of it, and now makes it worse.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. The more
I have a show, right? I have this food and travel thing.
Right.
And I was doing it for PBS. I did 6 episodes for PBS. Now it's on Netflix. But when it was on PBS, each time they said, "We want you to live tweet while the show is." And I'm like, "Why would I do that?" And they said, "Because that enhances the viewership." I'm like, "It does?" I said, "Here's what I want to tweet. Watch the goddamn show."
Yeah,
exactly. What are you looking at your phone for? Watch the show. They said, "Phil, they're going to be looking at their phone anyway. They may as well be looking at you." That's the world now.
It's true. But
I didn't have to live tweet during Raymond. People watch the damn show.
But you know how I feel, and I bet you feel the same way, why I like shows that have heart. And that's how I describe most of the things you do. And even the PBS show, a reality show about a guy going to different places and eating food and really experiencing it. Like, I just said, let me watch a little bit of this before I get him on the phone. And I said, well, I'll click on the Italy episode. And and I don't know if you're like me, we just naturally have... I don't know how you what the word you would even call it. I'm curious. What you tell me what the word is. But you mentioned you showed these people at the beginning of the episode that you met you met when you were young, and they gave you this. When you showed that little piece of paper, how they diagrammed where you should go and what you should eat in Italy, I was like, I'm in. I don't have ADD anymore. That's what happens. When you give them something that has that, like, it's almost like it gives you a little tingle in your body. You're like, ah, I feel like I know this guy's not even doing a show now. He's just he's being himself. And now, when you said I haven't seen him in 25 years, right at the beginning of the episode, I'm like, is he gonna is he gonna see him? Maybe he's gonna see him. That's gonna be an emotional thing too. And I'm like, and that's what Everybody Loves Raymond had too. Even when it was making you laugh, it was making you go, "Ah, oh, they love each other. Oh, this is great."
Oh, thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
And
so that is something that you learn to do.
Uh-huh.
If these are your values, and I got these values from watching a lot of TV as a kid and being attracted to movies that I was attracted to. So the shows that I loved were shows like The Dick Van Dyke Show and The Honeymooners and All in the Family and Mary Tyler Moore and Taxi and The Odd Couple. And I could go on and on. Mm-hmm. But the ones I just mentioned had in common was they were all real. In other words, they all were believable.
Right.
They weren't people from Mars. They weren't, you know, I Dream of Jeannie in a Bottle. They were people you could relate to as real people, and you could believe what was happening could actually happen, right?
Right, right.
And the other thing they had in common was they kept you engaged not because they were flashy and sexy and had many scenes that they were cutting back and forth and fancy costumes and things like this, the kind of superficial stuff that a lot of people in the entertainment business think is essential to holding your attention. Keep it moving. Keep it moving. I call that the illusion of entertainment, right?
Yeah.
They jingle so many things in front of your face that you, at the end of the 22 minutes, you think you were entertained.
Right.
But an episode of All in the Family, for instance, kept you in one room because of the content.
Right.
Because of the stories and the character. So if you're hooked into the story and the characters, you don't have to have any of the other crap, any of the superficial. In fact, it's the opposite of superficial.
Right.
It's deep. It's deeper. And you care. And so that's just what I was attracted to. And I learned how to craft stories like that.
Right. And how to make the audience care in a very quickly, right in the top, the cold open, right, you would say. Boom,
we're
in.
I guess so. Well, it hooks you in. The story hooks you in. It's not, oh, look at this girl in a bikini, which, yes, I enjoy that too.
Right.
But, you know, it's over. It's over in a couple minutes. Now I need another bikini.
Right.
You can't just have there are shows like that. It's called pornography.
Right.
You know, if that's what you're really going for, go ahead.
Because I'm searching for it. Do you think there's any shows on network television right now that are doing that?
That are great and hook you in with stories? I'm hooked in now by, I think, and I'm certainly not the first person to say this, but I believe that we're in a golden age of dramas.
Right.
The storytelling in dramas on television have taken the place of the storytelling in dramas that used to be movies. Like when we grew up, you would go to the movies and see something that had the storytelling of a Mad Men or a Breaking Bad or something like Hap and Leonard that I'm watching. Uh-huh. And this doesn't exist really anymore. Now it's Batman versus Superman.
Right.
I always say now that, you know, the work stops at the poster.
That's perfect. Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
They think of the poster. Well, who's popular? Well, Batman's popular. Superman's popular. Why don't we put them together? Okay, Batman and Superman. No. Batman versus Superman. Now it's a movie. And it seems like they forgot everything. Like the script, they forgot that.
Right. Now, when you were writing Everybody Loves Raymond's episodes, were you saying it's okay to throw a moment of drama here and there if we're would the network be afraid?
Not only is it, yeah, they're always afraid of it. They're afraid of any pause. They're afraid of any thinking. They're afraid of, you know, it's not moving. Let's go. You know, the superficial.
Right.
And so I learned from shows like The Honeymooners, and I think I wrote about this in my book even, as how much I loved it. Like, there was a great episode in The Honeymooners where Norton was hurt in the sewer. He was hurt, and he was hurt after he had a fight with Ralph, and Ralph didn't want to be his friend anymore. And then Ralph learns that he was hurt. And he's already replaced Norton as a friend with a guy who's exactly like Norton, which is hilarious.
Yeah.
And they're about to go bowling, and a guy comes in and says Norton was hurt. And you see Ralph stop.
Right.
And this was a moment like, and I'm a child watching this, and this had never happened before, a serious moment like this. And my heart went in my mouth. I was like, what do you mean Norton's hurt? This guy that I love, who only makes me laugh, who I think is the funniest person on earth, what do you mean hurt? It's like a family member was hurt,
right?
Is how I felt.
Uh-huh.
And so did Ralph. And Ralph rushes to help his friend, who's fine, of course, and then they play it for comedy.
Right.
But I'll never forget that.
Yeah.
I'll never forget the guy. His new friend goes, where are you going? I thought we were going bowling. My friend is hurt. If something happened to him, I'd never forgive myself. You just got done telling me what a booby is, right? He goes, what I say about Norton is one thing. How I feel about him is another. And he runs out the door. I tell you, I could cry thinking about it right now.
Right, yeah, and those are the ones. You, how many years later, and you're telling me on a podcast.
So yes.
What does that do? Say?
So what does that do when you have that dramatic moment? Well, it cements you to the characters. It cements you to them because they're real to you. And by the way, if we're talking about the craft of writing such things, what else does it do? It makes the very next moment even funnier.
Exactly.
Because it's in contrast to a dramatic moment.
Right. Opposites in sitcoms are just, they're gems when you can get them.
Well, it's essential.
Yes. Especially like Cheers. Cheers was so great. I mean, every character is just an exact opposite of the other guy. It's like every character is an opposite. And it's just, it's like a dream, you know? You know what it just made me think of? Like, and it would never work in a showbiz meeting if you were trying to say, listen, this is essential to making you care about the characters.
Yes.
They do it in reality television. Like, if you notice, anyone who's ever watched American Idol, you just made me realize why I only like the first five episodes and then I stop watching. The first five episodes.
Because you get their personal story about how they grew up and how they cared and how they makes you care. Why do you think before the Olympics, before every American gets into the ring with something or does something, they show you the 4-minute bio on them so that you care about them?
Yeah. It's funny. There used to, that year that I met you up in Montreal, might have been the year I was up there for this, but they used to do this showcase called Just for Pitching, where you would pitch a show idea in front of network execs, and they would have an audience there. So they would try to make it entertaining. Right. So they would kind of rip your idea up, even if it kind of might have been a good idea. And my listeners have heard me probably tell this story before. It's another place where the Fixing Joe concept of audience helping host idea came from. Yeah. But I was pitching an idea, and one of the networks had said to me after the pitch, you know, it's really interesting, but you need to decide if you want to if you want it to be funny or serious, because you can't do both. That's what they said to me. And I stood up for myself because I must have not cared, because I was realizing no one's selling a show here. This is to make the audience laugh. I said, you know, that's what's wrong with TV now. And they're like, what do you mean? I go, well, the great shows had moments of serious. Every once in a while, they dice it in there, and it made everything seem real and funnier. And, like, the whole audience gave me this, like, slow, Rudy, like, clap.
Yeah.
But actually, a guy...
Look at a sitcom like Transparent.
Mm-hmm.
It's really a half-hour drama when you think about it. There's certainly funny moments in it, but if I'm watching it, I'm thinking that this is dramatic. This is a drama. The line has been blurred, especially by single camera sitcoms.
Jeez, yeah, forget it. Louis' show, there'll be full dramatic episodes. That'll be in all of a sudden, you think you're watching a 22-minute show. You're like, this one's looking long. This one's 2 hours. What just happened? It's a movie.
Yeah, He made that movie about himself as a kid working for that drug dealer or something. That was an amazing movie.
I love it.
If that was in the movie theater, you would have been like, wow, this is the best movie this year.
Exactly. Jeremy Renner's in it playing a dramatic drug dealer. I'm like, okay. I feel like in show business, I've always been a hair ahead of my time, and it kind of gets me. And they always think I'm nuts. And then like 4 years later, all the shows are what I was trying to pitch. You know, I remember pitching.
Well, there you go. You must be on to something.
But to get it to match up is very difficult. I've wanted to do a sitcom where I was like, maybe I could do a sitcom where we see my real family mixed in, diced in. That was one idea I had once, like, because I love the movie American Splendor with Paul Giamatti, how you see the real people mixed in with the acted out versions.
Yep.
And I was like, whoa, I wonder if you could do that as a sitcom. I wonder if that would play. And they're like, every manager's like, what do you know? You can't do that. That'll confuse everything. I'm like, I don't know. I guess I like confusing. I don't know.
What are you asking them for? You got to just do it.
I know. That was
if they know how to do it, they would do it.
Exactly. Yeah. That is why your book, You're Lucky You're Funny. I actually listened to the whole audiobook on a trip somewhere, and once I heard it, I started telling every comedian and writer the one major thing that I took from it was where you said how specific to be as specific as you can about yourself, and you'll be more relatable.
Well, that's absolutely true. That's you, and I learned that by accident. That if you tell something specific, it's actually more relatable. You'll hit more people than if you're vague in general. You think if I'm general. That'll hit everybody, and of course you miss everybody.
Yeah,
because we relate to each other's specifics, because we all deal in specifics in our own lives. So just the fact that you're saying a specific about, let's say, your Italian upbringing, right? I'm going to relate to it, even though I'm not Italian, because I have an upbringing that I can relate to, that is as specific as yours.
Right. Well, let's.
And then, of course, if you hit the jackpot, where your mother did that, my mother did that, right?
Right, exactly. Yeah, their own version of whatever it was.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's like even my son, when he was young, and he would try to be funny sometimes, and sometimes he'd accidentally be funny, and it would be hilarious, and then he would try to be funny, and it wasn't funny. I was like,
right.
I even tried to explain to him when he was young. I'm like, you know, you don't need to try so hard. It's like, just be you. You'll be fine. You're hilarious when you're not even trying.
There's plenty of adults who need that.
So let's talk a little bit about your upbringing. Like, and this sounds like I'm segueing, but I really did want to talk about your upbringing.
Speaking of dramatic moments.
Well, we have that in common because I live close to where you grew up. I'm on the other side of the Tappan Zee, but I have a few friends that are from New City in Rockland County. What high school did you go to there?
Clarkstown North.
Say it again.
Clarkstown North.
Oh, did you say in Larchtown?
Clarkstown.
Oh, Clark's.
Like Clark.
Oh. Oh, okay. Yes. I've watched them play. I live in New Rochelle for the last 2.5 years, and I've watched Clarkstown North play New Rochelle in football, and it was not pretty. We killed you. But
I could care less about the sport.
Me too.
which got me beaten up on a regular basis.
So you grew up there, and then Hofstra is right after high school, I'm guessing.
That's right.
Did you want to stay close to home?
Not particularly. No, it didn't matter to me. But Hofstra was an hour and a half away, so it may as well have been on the other side of the country for the amount of times I came home or saw my folks.
Now, I don't know if this is before your time at all, but going to college there, because watching your commencement speech, how loud the dramatic department is when you start talking about how it's a great drama school or great for the arts. And that's one of my negatives in life is, you know, I really didn't go to college very long and I dropped out. I didn't even know. No one guided me towards artistic kind of schools like that. And how did you, were you like in theater in high school and you were just, you had known?
Yeah. All I wanted to do, watching TV, watching The Honeymooners, watching all those shows I mentioned, all I wanted to do was be funny like that. I just wanted to be funny.
Right.
And the only outlet for that, for me, was the school plays. Because when I tried to be funny in class, they didn't like it so much.
Now,
kids liked it, but I would get in trouble.
Were you just cast in, like, comedies at school? I mean, it's rare that they do comedies in school plays, right?
No, they do anything. They do, you know, there was always, like, one big musical comedy in the spring, and then there would be maybe one other play. Or we also had a theater kind of club where we'd do improvisation, and that was kind of handed down from seniors to the underclassmen, and then we would become seniors, and then we would kind of know the improvisational games and things like that. And that was essential, I thought. I didn't even realize how essential it was. And I still tell people that an improv class is kind of the best training you can have for so many aspects of writing and directing and acting. It really is amazing because it teaches you to make hard and fast choices and commit, you know,
right.
but leaving the thinking part of the brain that screws us up, the overthinking of things, you know?
Yeah.
It teaches you to go on instinct. And of course, the better you get at it, the more relaxed you'll be. And that just makes you even better. I always tell people, there's a basic tenet of improv. And it's the phrase, yes, and. So yes, and is, do you take improv at all, or have you?
No, but I've done little bits of it in lots of the acting classes that I've taken over the years. You know, once in a while,
right.
You get someone in your class who has a deep improv background, and then they'll, like, sometimes
right.
make you do some of the exercises.
So yes, and means... Let's say you and I are doing a scene, mm-hmm. and we're improvising, meaning we're coming up with it as we go. And I said, boy, there's a lot of traffic today. And you say, yes, and there's a guy walking in front of me right now, and he's wearing a blue space suit. And I say, yes, and he's coming over and asking me for money. What, do you give an alien money? So yes, and means you accept the information that's given to you.
Right.
And you add to it.
Hmm.
So I start to realize this is not just a great rule of improvisation. This is a rule of life.
Sure.
Be positive.
Right.
And be positive and contribute.
Right.
That really is, everything should be yes, and. Everything in life should be yes, and here's what I can do. Yes, and here's my contribution to the world.
It's the
right?
It's the opposite of Twitter.
It could be.
Everything on Twitter,
you know,
is negative, and they,
by the way,
and they
my
want
daughter,
the... Go ahead.
My daughter gave me a great lesson in social media because she says I'm so terrible at it, and I am. But she said, Dad, listen, Twitter is for funny things. Instagram is for pretty things. Facebook is for old people things.
That's why I stopped doing these Periscope videos, and I started doing the Facebook, because Facebook just started having a thing on there that you can do streaming videos now, and I started doing them every morning around right before I'm about to exercise, about 10 minutes.
And is that popular? Do people like that?
Yeah, well, that's what you start to realize when you're a comedian that's talking about his kids, medication, all the things that dads
yeah.
and parents and homeowners go through. You're throwing that out to Twitter. It's like you're throwing it to, it's like you're literally throwing it to nothing. Whereas you throw it on Facebook and you're seeing all these people interact, and you can just feel that it's for the older people. So yeah, it works.
Yeah.
It works. And I started teasing the episodes for the podcast that way. I'm like, I'll talk about it for 10 minutes on a video, and then hopefully I link them in and they want to hear the episode. There was an, oh yeah. So, you're making me think, cause I you know, a typical stand-up comedian, and you probably know from knowing Ray Romano pretty well. You know, it's not like we're getting sitcom auditions every 2 days. It's like, it's hilarious that, like, you'll get a sitcom audition, and you haven't been on a sitcom audition in 8 months, right?
Right.
Next thing you know, you're in there doing one, and you're like, ah, that one didn't go so well. And, like, I'm starting, you get older and you get more mature. You're like, why would that go well? I haven't done it in 8 months, you know?
Of course. Yes, listen, my wife is an actress, and you know, it's a long time between jobs a lot of times, right?
Right.
So she just told me about an audition she did yesterday. She said, I felt so bad because I just didn't know what the hell I was doing. I said, it's only because you're rusty. Doesn't mean you're a bad actor. It means that it's like anything else. If you were a baseball player and you hadn't swung the bat in 8 months, you wouldn't be as good a hitter.
Right. Exactly. Like, I should have said this because I do a little monologue before I bring the guest on that you don't get to hear. And there's a lot of different sound clips and stuff edited through the podcast. But I had a gig. Yeah. I had a gig a couple days ago that I took because, you know, my cousin, he doesn't really do stand up. He's more of a motivational speaker, but he dabbles in stand up. And every once in a while, he'll get these gigs at schools. And it was like a high school where they wanted me to teach a workshop on stand up to 15 kids for about an hour and 20 minutes. And then they wanted us to do a stand-up show for the whole student body. And this is a private Catholic school in New Jersey, 7th grade to 12th graders. All boys.
Holy cow.
All boys, not a girl there.
Wow.
I'm about 2 minutes in and I realize, I'm like, one, why didn't I prepare? And you know what? I do stand-up 4 or 5 days a week. Like, there's not a rusty... I'm ready, you know what I mean? And it was horrendous. I'm like, I don't know what to say to a 7th grader. I just no idea how to be funny right now except to say, this is not going well. Like, that's funny the first couple times.
Right.
But yeah, it's funny. That, like, but when you said improv class, it's like I've said that out loud. I go, I should probably take an improv class. I bet that is a good... skill, because you said make hard choices. Now, you're behind the scenes. I'm sure you were in every...
By the way, when I say hard choices, I don't mean like difficult choices.
I mean like
solid, like make a clean shot at something. Don't make a wishy-washy choices.
Right. Be fully committed and stick.
Exactly.
Whatever you made, and I'm sure you were, you know, in all the big audition parts of Everybody Loves Raymond, and I think I've heard you tell the story about Brad Garrett's audition as the brother. Did he come in as this character? Because that's as strong of a choice as you can really, that you really, have, I don't know, I'm trying to think of other sitcom characters that were just character.
It's very simple. We were looking for the part calls for Ray's older brother to be jealous of him, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we thought an older brother might be jealous of a younger brother if he was shorter than his younger brother,
mm-hmm.
right?
Right.
That makes him jealous automatically. Why is my younger brother taller than me? So we were looking for a shorter person. And by the way, in real life, Ray has a older brother.
Right.
And so that was what was in my head. Then this talking tree walked in the room. So he didn't have any say in making that choice. That was the casting director said, you know what, go in anyway, right? You never know.
Mm-hmm.
Because Brad Garrett is someone who's naturally really funny, and the casting director is thinking, maybe they'll like that. Maybe they'll see the part differently if you come in.
Mm-hmm.
And he came in. And just the way, and, you know, so we're already laughing at how big he is. Then we start laughing at the hangdog expression on his face. And then when he opened his mouth and comes out, we fell over because he was so hysterical and perfect for the role. We didn't even have a close second choice. It wasn't even close.
Really?
He was undeniable. undeniable how funny he was.
Did you ever ask him what made him make that like dopey sounding voice and how to commit to something that's not even yes. sounding like yourself? He doesn't talk anything like that, right?
By the way, it was a little dopier than we wanted. Uh-huh. It, you know, we didn't want him to be a cartoon.
Right.
But listen to this. This is really funny. He during the rehearsals for the pilot, his natural way is to be kind of, in his act, in his stand-up, he's kind of a Don Rickles type. He's very caustic and very, you know, he does insult humor, he does shocking, you know, racial stuff, and mm-hmm. the way that Rickles does, right?
Right.
He's not a racist by any means. He just says things to be shocking, knowing how wrong it is.
He's like a Lisa Lampanelli type.
Yeah, shocking and caustic and truly like Rickles.
Right.
So he was bringing kind of that edge to the part. And so it wasn't working so well in rehearsal. And I told him, I think that it is more of a hangdog thing. It is more of a sad sack. It's more of a put-upon guy. He's more, he accepts the fact that he's, you know, not as beloved as Raymond in his own family, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm looking for a sadder kind of, and he goes, like Eeyore. And I said, yes, Eeyore. Eeyore is the perfect Eeyore from Winnie the Pooh, the sad little donkey. The guy, that's fantastic. And he goes, I am Eeyore. I said, what do you mean? He goes, I'm the voice of Eeyore in the cartoon.
So maybe, yeah, okay. So he brought that in, too.
Keep doing that, yes.
So you're saying in the audition that got him the part, he was doing a little bit of an Eeyore thing. Then he
exactly
stopped.
Right.
He stopped doing it a little bit?
Well, during rehearsal, uh-huh. you start trying stuff on, seeing what works. Uh-huh. And when I saw that, you know, oh, he'd like to be a little edgier, he'd like to do, I'm like, nope, I think it's what you first did, this kind of sad sack guy. That's what's endearing and sweet and hilarious. And he just hit me with that Eeyore thing, and I was like, that, you're a genius, then. Keep doing that.
That's amazing. Yeah, that is something, man. You gotta have balls to just really, really like. I had an audition recently for this guy Sebastian Maniscalco. You probably know who he is because it's probably talked about a lot in Hollywood. To play his brother, right? And you read it in the description. It says, "Schlubby fat guy, very much like a Patton Oswalt type." And I'm like, I'm 170 pounds. I'm Italian. I'm not this guy at all. So you're like, all right. Then you sit there and you start making all these weird choices and you start practicing it. And you sit there and think you want to go, I'm going to have to put on a whole, I'll have to put on a whole character to do it. And then you start messing around with it. And then I go into my acting class. I actually take acting class with the guy who played Larry on Three's Company. It's pretty classic.
Right.
You know, the guy who was like the stud. John Ritter's friend. So, he's like, just do it as you, doing it as you is hilarious. He's like, just go as you. Go fast so you don't even have time to think about it. You can't even second guess your choice. Just fly through it. Because I'm a slow talker in real life. I have a deliberate delivery. I'm not fast. And, and even when I'm going fast, I'm not fast. So he was like, just get, you're overthinking it. Your insecure brain's kicking in. Just go really fast. And then all of a sudden everybody in the room's laughing at the scene. And I'm like, okay, all right. So yeah,
there you go.
But it's still confusing when you cause you see guys like, he's someone that comes into my head is Brad Garrett as Ray's brother doing a completely different guy as him getting the part and being on a show for 9 years. What would you equal that to? He's not being himself.
I don't know.
Would you say he was himself in that, though?
Well, there's certainly, you can't be, all acting is taking parts of what must be in your personality and bringing them forward, right?
Right.
So I think the best actors, they find what's most like them in the characters that they play.
Right.
So that it's the most natural.
That's a good point. That's a good point. So let's cut forward, because you know we could talk about Everybody Loves Raymond forever. It's just a perfect show, and especially
thank
you know
you.
To the Italians, we thank you. We love Italians.
Well,
really, they resonated with my parents. Loved that show. Loved that.
Well, I must have been Italian in another life or something, because I so identify. I so love Italy, and I love the Italian people, and I just love, I'm so crazy about the culture and the spirit and the food and the everything. It's all connected. And then, you know, I always said that the Jews and Italians are so, they're not so different anyway. All problems are solved with food, and the mother never leaves you alone.
Right, right. I mean, that's probably why I connected with your Italy episode. And, like, I actually just went to Israel for 10 days and thought their food was better than Italy. Have you been to Israel?
I don't know about that. But, yes, I think that was my favorite thing about Israel was the food.
It's
otherwise, I found it to be a lot like Hebrew school.
There is a lot of, they don't stop teaching you when you're in Israel. It's unbelievable. You're like, wow,
yeah,
can we stop learning?
Leave me alone already. I grew up with it. Shut up already.
So is the PBS show, because I've been watching it on Netflix, which I looked today and was said 2015,
yeah.
And it's season one. Is there a season two?
We are talking about it right now.
Oh, okay, great. Okay, so so you're basically, Leisha, direct people to watch season one, and that's basically the only place they could find it right now is Netflix. Is PBS still airing the reruns?
Maybe in certain local places, but I think you might be able to stream it at pbs.org, but the easiest place to watch it and to watch it on television is on Netflix.
Right, and it's called I'll Have What Phil's Having. Now,
yeah.
I don't want to ask, is there anything that was like, I know you have to go to lunch probably. Are you in the parking lot of where you're eating? Are you there yet?
I'm getting close.
Where's Phil having lunch?
Today, I'm going to the Gorilla Taco Truck, which I actually featured in the LA episode, but I love it so much that I try to go there as much as I can.
Is that enough?
That was my first entrance. When you saw me eat it in the L.A. episode, that was the first time I ever had it, and I've been about 100 times since then.
Is that in the farmer's market?
No, that's the one that's at the truck that we went to in downtown L.A., and I'm headed to downtown L.A. right now to have some with one of the guys. Oh, no, this guy wasn't in the I was going to say I was meeting the guy that's in the episode, but this is a different guy. But what we have in common is we love these tacos, and they change them up every day with fresh ingredients. This is a great chef.
Really?
Who does the world's best tacos out of his truck. He was born in East L.A. He trained in France with Alain Ducasse, one of the great chefs of the world, and learned how to cook fancy.
Really?
Then he took all this knowledge and brought it back to East L.A. and said, I want to make tacos for the people. And so he's like a folk hero. His name is Wes Avila.
Oh, I'm gonna have to find out where that is, because I'm coming to L.A. the first week of June, and I've never been to this place. No, wow. What?
Gorilla Tacos. He changes locations, you know, on a weekly or daily basis, and you look him up on Twitter or Facebook, and you see where he is that day, where the truck is, and you know, you can. I think I said in the show, I want to follow him around like the Grateful Dead.
Where's the best Italian food in Los Angeles?
Mozza,
yeah, that's what my cousin says. I've been to Mozza once. It's good. It's
the Osteria, the Osteria, the pizzeria.
I think I was at the Osteria. Yeah, I don't think I've had the pizza yet.
And now there's a new place next door, so there's three versions of Mozza, and the new one is called Chispacca, which means the cleaver. And it's a Tuscan steak grill. Everything is grilled over wood, and they have a wood oven, and they make it's rustic Italian grit. I mean, absolutely fantastic. You can get the bistecca fiorentina, that 3 1/4 inch thick steak grilled over the fire. This is one of the best things you'll ever eat.
It sounds like LA's come around, because that was like, I only had lived there for a year and a half, I guess in 2000, 16 years ago, and that was like the thing, that LA sucked for food, and if you were from New York, you were going to hate it. Oh, you're not going to get good pizza. And now it's pretty good. Like, you still miss New York?
No? I do for certain things, but I have to say that LA has now surpassed New York as a food city. I think it's the best food city in Los Angeles.
Really? Wow.
Really? Watch the LA episode of my show.
I will.
And I make a case for it. And I was a New York snob. I mean, you know, in many ways, New York is I'm from there, and I have a great deal of pride for New York. But there's something about LA that as I get older, I really appreciate.
Wow. Better tacos.
It's not even a fair fight. We have just a tremendous amount, even more diversity, if you can believe it.
Really?
Which is the strength.
That sounds like your next book is just on LA food.
It could be.
So you were there. I didn't even realize it. So you don't move to LA till you're like in your late 20s?
Yeah, 29.
Wow. So what held you back from making the big West Coast move?
I hated LA. I had no reason to go there.
I've seen this. I've heard you talk about this, but what happens that brings you to Los Angeles?
Somebody saw me in a play in New York and said if I came to LA, and this was an agent, I would never stop working as an actor. So I packed a bag and I moved to LA and I never started working as an actor.
Is he still around, this guy?
I hope not.
Was he a big agent? Like, who says that? Like, how do they? Because acting is one of the hardest things to get work at. You'll never stop working.
This will be a mystery to me for as long as I live. But when I got here, and he was a pretty big agent, I think. I don't need to say his name. But when I opened the door to his office to say, I'm here, right? Jimmy J.J. Walker was in the office. And I thought, wow, he handles J.J. Walker. I'm going to do – this will be great.
Right.
He's a big agent.
He must have been at that time. Is this during Good Times?
No, this is 10 years after Good Times.
Oh, okay. So it's you're a complete idiot.
That's how I feel. And I go in there and he goes and you don't have to be in the business to understand this story. He goes, I'm so glad you're here. I have an agent here who's going to handle you. I said, oh, it's not going to be you? He said, no. You know, I run the whole agency, but I have an agent here. She's going to handle you. I said, well, did she see the play? Did she see me in anything? No, but she'll love you. You'll see. Well, that lady, meet her. I would call her on the phone and she wouldn't even pick up the phone. So I was being handed off to somebody who had their own clients, who had no interest in a new client, didn't even care who I was. I didn't understand.
You're cutting out a little bit. I don't know if you're switching. Are you switching rooms?
I'm standing right here.
Okay.
he said, why would you say move to LA to some guy who's going to change his life and come and live there and then not follow up? I couldn't understand it. But what I realized was, oh, this is the bullshit of Hollywood.
Exactly.
That was the first lesson.
Yeah.
And so I had to keep that in the back of my mind as I went through life. And then I started, you know, I took odd jobs here and I met other agents here, and that was crazy and terrible. One lady, I mean, I'm nothing to look at, but one lady agent was like telling me that 29 was a sexy age and I should use it. I'm like, what do you mean use it? Use it for what? I didn't even know what the hell she was talking about. And then I realized, oh, she likes younger guys. This is I never thought of myself that way for one second. I thought that shows you how crazy this place is. They're coming after me.
Now, because you have a really happy, positive personality, and I'm wondering, did it ever start to affect your personality? Or
yes, I get depressed like everybody else.
Back then,
nothing special. Of course, not only back then, right now.
Right now, yeah, that's what.
Of course,
that's what every successful.
Like everybody.
Yeah, that's what every successful person in show business says, that it doesn't really change you. It just kind of, I don't know. What does it change? It has to change something.
Okay, here's what I truly think. You can't you feel about yourself the way you're going to feel about it. And all your achievements and everything, you can they don't really comfort you in the present day, because whatever you achieve is in the past. The moment you achieve it, it's now in the past.
Right.
It doesn't do you any good to sit there and go, I did this and then I did that. Okay, what are you doing now? Remembering this and that. It doesn't help you as a human being. What it should, when your dreams come true, is it should make you nicer. I'll never understand people who are rotten to other people. First of all, life's hard enough. Please just observe the golden rule. Do unto others, we'd all get along very nicely.
Right.
But beyond that, I'll never understand the entitled human being who thinks because they've achieved their dreams that now they get to lord it over their fellow human beings. That you have to be nice. I don't get it. And beyond that, if you are so lucky, and that's how I feel, extremely lucky, I think you give back a little bit. I think you, and at the very least, you just are nice to people.
Right.
Because you get to be one of the lucky people who get to live their dream.
Yeah.
So, yes, that's me. I'm the luckiest person you'll ever talk to. That's how I feel. And I pretty much love my life and love people. It doesn't mean that I'm just a sunny idiot who's smiling all the time.
No, but I'm curious about before the dream of getting to do Everybody Loves Raymond. Before that, if there was like a jaded, complaining, neurotic guy then.
Even when I was an outer, beaten down on a daily basis, rejection. By the way, I would have loved some rejection. I couldn't even get in the room to be rejected.
Right.
I couldn't even get the audition. I couldn't even get an agent. I couldn't get anything. I had nothing. And yet, on my way to the terrible temp job, to the terrible phone sales job, or the security guard job, or the bartending job, I actually remember thinking to myself how lucky I am to live in a place where I get to pursue just the very of pursuing your dream,
right,
is more than most people on the planet has.
That's true,
right?
Yeah, you get. It's funny. That's you learn so much. That's what's great about doing a podcast. By the way, it's like the one thing that I've observed about it is you're like the fans were always at the shows, and then you would never really see them again, and then you'd go to another show. And then whatever. But something about a podcast is this intimate thing where, and then with social media on top of it, you start to
connect to people. You connect.
Yeah, it's a deeper connection. And you get, you start to get a lot of that kind of connection. Like, dude, you know how lucky you are that you get to do this? I'm like, well, because they would hear me complain and they're like, dude, my job sucks. And you're like,
that's
oh
right.
my God. Yeah.
You get to do something fun and nice that you enjoy.
Right.
You get to even pursue that. Just the pursuit of that, the pursuit of happiness.
Right.
The pursuit of happiness.
Yeah.
It's in the declaration. Here we are. We get to do that. Now, I'm not being a, blind patriot, just saying God bless America, how great we are, but that was a very good That I love. That's my favorite phrase in the whole thing.
Right.
and the pursuit of happiness. That's an emotional thing. That's a human thing.
Yeah.
It's not just some law, right?
Right. And I love to try to find the negative. I'm like, all right. Uh-huh. So you probably realized it really early on of being the showrunner at Everybody Loves Raymond. Wow, I'm doing the thing that I've wanted. This is it. I know it. Like you knew it really early on. Like, wow.
I appreciated it every second. Appreciated it.
Right.
Because I knew how hard it was to get.
Right. You weren't 25.
Yeah, I was 35.
35 at the beginning, and yeah, okay, so you're 44 by the time it's over. Was there
exactly?
Was there anything? There's not one thing that I bet I already know your answer. There wasn't one thing that you would complain about during that process. Well, sure. I mean, I guess the network notes.
There were a ton of things to complain about. Uh-huh. I always can find something to complain about, but right. Underneath it all. You know, again, we're not just one thing, right? Uh-huh. But the overriding thing in my head was, these are the good problems.
Right.
They're bothering you on your television show,
mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
It's like there's always ants at the picnic, but look, you're still at a picnic.
So
these are the good problems.
So what do you think? What's the hardest part about having a television show? What's the hardest thing?
You can't possibly be prepared for being the boss if you've never done that before. Mm-hmm. So like I'm a writer, right? So mm-hmm. I write alone in my room. I write the pilot of Everybody Loves Raymond. And what am I thinking when I'm writing this? I hope that the one person at CBS likes it enough to let me film the pilot.
Right.
Right. And then when they do, you're like, wow, I get to make a show. I get to make a TV show, one TV show. And I hope it's good enough that it makes it onto the schedule. Once you get that, you're now going from a writer, a guy who wrote a thing alone, to being the boss of 150 people.
Jeez.
That's a crazy... It's crazy. And you think, how am I going to be? I understand the job because I've been close to it working for others on their television shows. And I learned a lot about what to do. I also learned a lot about what not to do. And so I even learned about different personas and how you should be as the boss. And I saw them all. And the way I chose to be was be nice. That was the main thing I was trying to keep in the back of my head. Yes, the work comes first. Yes, we'd like the work to be good. Yes, we have to be professional, all these things. But if you're nice, I think it will make it for a better work environment.
Right.
It was really like it was a calculated thing to and I couldn't do it any other way. Like I couldn't – if you look at me, I'm not an imposing figure.
Right.
You could probably hear just by my voice, this is not someone to be taken very seriously.
Yeah, I can't even picture you yelling at somebody.
Exactly. So I didn't have much of a choice but to be nice. But believe me, it was a conscious choice. We all – and that's a lesson too. We all have a decision to get up in the morning. How are you going to be today? You're going to be in a bad mood? It's really your choice. I wake up in the morning, things aren't going my way sometimes, and I'm like, I'm sad. Then I have a cup of coffee, I feel a little better. Then then I find something good in my day that I want to do, lunch. I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to lunch. After lunch, you know, I got to go back to whatever work I'm doing and the frustration sometimes that comes with that. But I'm going to see my wife later and my kid, and I'm going to have dinner, and that'll be fun.
Right.
So as long as we keep having things to look forward to, and I tried to have that at work as well. So one of the main important things I thought that went along with being nice to the people I was working with was to make sure the food was really good on the set. because it made for a beautiful, fun working environment. And people look forward to that. That's a very simple thing, a very specific thing that you can do wherever you work to make it better and to make people get along well together is have good food. That brings it to, it's such a connector.
It is. And then, and you sound similar to me. And when you're doing something for people that they appreciate and you know that you just, it makes you feel good that you just like, look, you were literally picking the food out.
I would, that was part of what I love doing. Yes. Yeah. I would talk about, you know, what can we have on the set this week that would be special? Well, I heard there are these cinnamon buns in Chicago. Can we get those?
Really?
Can we fly in Delhi from New York this week? That'll be special and nice. Can we get this food truck to park outside during the taping and then everyone will get to have, you know, In-N-Out burgers or whatever, you know, is great. Can we, oh, someone makes tacos. They can make tacos backstage on their portable thing and make different tacos for, oh yeah, we can do. Yeah.
Some people would just be too focused on the job and be like, oh my God, I got to have a great episode every week. And oh my God, this guy.
Yes. And believe me, I was, especially when we started, I was kind of a nervous wreck about the show being good. I cared very, very deeply. First of all, I'm writing it, this was going to be my one shot, I felt, to write about my family. Yes, it was based on Raymond's actual family, but what I didn't know about the characters in his family, I filled in with the characters of my family. And a lot of the situations and stories were coming from stuff that happened to me.
Right.
And so here, this show served as a kind of vehicle to tell those stories. And so it was very personal.
Uh-huh. Did you realize that in the first meeting for Ray Romano that you were that
no.
that your life was going to translate right into him?
No, we had no idea what the show was going to be. As a matter of fact, Ray actually thought that maybe the show could be 1996. I want to say, yeah. That why couldn't the show be about him being a comedian and sitting in the diner and talking with other comedians and no story and just make jokes?
Right.
And I'm like, well, first of all, there is that show already. It's called Seinfeld.
Right.
And second, I wouldn't know how to write that show. That's not what I really, it's not my world. So I don't really relate to it. And maybe I'm not that good a writer because I can only write stuff that I know.
Right,
that I understand. And the shows that I was brought up with, the ones we mentioned earlier, those were kind of that was my wheelhouse. That's what I felt comfortable with. And he says, well, like, what would you write about? And I said, I don't know. Why don't you tell me about yourself? And he tells me, oh, I live in Queens. I got twin boys and older daughter. My parents live close by, and they're always bothering me. And my brother is kind of jealous of me. He touches every bite of food to his chin before he eats it. He's a police sergeant. And he saw an award I won once for comedy, and he said, oh, it never ends for Raymond. He goes, everybody loves Raymond. And I said, well, it doesn't seem like there's anything there we can use.
He literally said the title out loud and didn't even realize it.
Exactly. And then when I put that in the script, and my wife saw it, I didn't have a title for the show. My wife read the script. And she was very nice, very supportive, as always. And she said, that should be the title. I said, what? She goes, where the brother says, everybody loves Raymond. I said, no, I guess. Okay. I didn't have a better. And when Raymond saw the title, he goes, you can't call it that. I'm like, why not? He goes, I don't want to be that guy. Would you want to be the person everybody supposedly loves? It's like asking for it.
What'd you say?
Not everybody loves Raymond. I can see the reviews now. Be that guy. I can't call it. Don't call it that. I said, okay, we'll just use it as temporary. Well, we never thought of anything better. Raymond really tried to think of better titles. He even had a list of titles like That Raymond Guy, Raymond's Tree, comma, Raymond. You know, just there was a hilarious list. It got to, he was so mortified of calling the show that he called the president of CBS and he said, please, can we not call it that? And the guy goes, listen, we've tested different titles. We tested the ones you liked even. And Everybody Loves Raymond won, you know, the tested the best. He goes, but I tell you what, you become a top 10 show, you can change it to whatever you want, right? So Ray says, okay. So the following year, not only were top 10 show, we're their number one show, right? And he calls Les Moonves. And he says, remember you said I could change the title? He goes, you can't change it now. You're a top 10 show.
That's hilarious. He still didn't love it. That's interesting.
He still doesn't like it.
He still doesn't like the name.
Today, 20 years later, really? He doesn't like it. Of course not.
Oh, it's perfect.
He has a joke. He has a joke that, you know, how success has changed him. He goes, it hasn't changed me. The only thing that changes, it used to be my taxi driver used to hate me. Now my limo driver hates me.
Yeah, comedians are I'd say writers are a little bit less nuts than comedians. We will find an issue.
God bless him for being that way. You know, there's a lot of neurotic types in show business who they take out all their stuff on you, mm-hmm. right? Ray is the most beautiful kind of neurotic because he only hurt himself.
Right.
Yeah. He hated himself, and that was fine. That was fine. He's the loveliest guy. He's a great actor. He couldn't be funnier. He's every department. He's a great writer too. He's one of my dear friends, and we shared this very beautiful thing together. You know, that it's a very small club that we got to be in.
Right.
You know, it's like, and I feel that way about not just him, but all the writers who were in the room with us. It's like when you see war buddies who've been through that thing together and they have a bond that will never be broken.
Right.
We went through this thing. We shared this thing. We shared some downs, certainly, but amazing that most of the planet, they don't get to have that. And so we love getting together. We love laughing. It's like we never were apart. You know, we get it's family. It's family in the room for 9 years together. That's all of high school, all of college, even a little graduate school thrown in.
Right.
Of being like that with people. And you see every side of them. You see, you know, there's even, you know, tragedies happen in families and stuff, and you share that with them. There's nobody you're closer to except your own personal family.
Right. And
that's a nice thing.
And we lost Peter Boyle after that show, correct?
A year after.
So, wow, that must have been an emotional thing for everybody that was part of that show.
Well, we knew he was ill. It was one of the reasons we had to I didn't want to talk about it,
mm-hmm.
but at the time, there were a couple of reasons we had to stop. That was one. The other reason was we didn't have any more ideas. we did 210 episodes. That's a lot of anything to do. Now, that doesn't stop some people from continuing.
Right.
They may be out of ideas. They start repeating ideas, or the show becomes terrible. But I thought of that old show business axiom. You should get off the stage before someone says, hey, you should get off the stage.
Right. Now,
and so I think that it served us well to end well because the show is still welcome.
Well, are you a guy that I mean, now you're doing, you know, I guess you still write books. The scripted writing, is that side of you getting facilitated because you're doing a reality show about cooking? I mean, I guess you kind of have to write beats, maybe, or what do you want to write a sitcom again?
I never say never, but I've had ups and downs in that department in the intervening years between Raymond and now. I've written sitcoms. The business has changed. I can't say that what Raymond was may even be valued in today's more because it's very, on the surface, it's a very mild show, right? There's nothing really sexy or hip about it.
Right.
And by the way, we got those notes. Could it be hotter and sexier? I'm like, hotter and sexier? Have you seen who do you want to see in a bathing suit in this show? Right? It's not everybody wants everything to be at least Friends, which is mild by today's standards too. But Friends, and I've talked about this before, but Friends was a very good show, but it was not good for the business in one respect, and that is that many shows, many executives, that the secret to Friends was that all the people in it were attractive.
Right.
Well, the truth is that was an exception to the rule, Friends, because here was a show where you had six really good-looking people who were also charming and funny. That rarely happens. God rarely gives with both hands, right?
Yeah.
And so they just have beautiful people in your sitcom.
Right.
And that'll be, and make them sexy. And that'll be, we'll have it. And no, it doesn't work that way.
That's
we
like,
don't go, we like don't go baseball, to hot, sexy yeah, girls like when baseball for our comedy needs.
It's like when baseball teams pick all great guys and then they suck because there's no chemistry.
You need chemistry. You need people have to work together. Yes. Yeah. And comedy is this whole other thing.
Right.
So I feel like the business has gotten way than less edgier stuff. Regular family stuff is not really that welcome.
So I'm going to have to cross you off my list, Phil. I have you written down as if anyone I could pick to be my showrunner if I get a sitcom. I had Phil Rosenthal number one. He's off
well,
the
I
list.
Well, I wouldn't. Well, that's very nice. I would take me right off the list because I don't think I'm welcome in a lot of places.
Who cares?
And after my head against the wall in the new Hollywood, I think I won. Because I stopped chasing that and did my ultimate dream, which took a good 10 years to bring to fruition. But now, you know, having a food and travel show combine everything I love, including the part of the business that involves writing, performing even, directing, editing, producing even. All of that, making a show, is in there. Plus, it's about all the other things in life that I love. Family, friends, food, travel, humor. It's all there.
Right.
So I'm combining all these things into what to me is a nice second act for me.
Right. Who's out there in Hollywood that has your style in writing a television show? If someone came and said, "Hey, I'm looking at somebody to do something like what I saw on Everybody Loves Raymond," who would you recommend?
I would recommend any of the guys that worked on our show.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Right?
How many of them are showrunners now, or did any of them go into the next end of it?
Mike Royce did the show with Ray called Men of a Certain Age, which is a great show.
I knew Mike Royce too. Good
so
guy.
He right now he's working with Norman Lear on a reboot of One Day at a Time, a Latino version of One Day at a Time.
Oh, I heard about that. Okay.
That's for Netflix also.
Is that going to be like an old style sitcom in front of a studio audience on Netflix?
You got it.
That'll be the first one. Oh, wow.
Oh no, they're doing Full House already.
Oh, that's right. I watched that. I had to shut that off. But that was bad.
It's not for everybody.
It does not work. It didn't work for me. But it almost feels like the studio audience isn't there, even though we hear one. I don't know why. It looks odd. I don't know. It looks like they did some lower-end version of making a sitcom. Am I wrong? Something looks off.
I haven't seen it.
Okay.
How's that for avoiding the issue?
Okay. I'm just curious, like, if there is a way. Why isn't there a way to make a sitcom look like a regular sitcom and have it be on Netflix? Or look at
Netflix is just the place where it's being shown. You can make it look any way you want.
True. Who knows? A guy like Louis C.K. is selling television shows right off his website now. It's amazing.
Yep.
There's no rules.
No. No, there's more outlets than ever to have your work done. There's no excuse for anybody. Anybody in the business now, it's like, well, I have an idea. So go do it. You have a phone. You can make it on your phone.
Yeah, it's true.
Put it on the web.
Yeah.
Somebody likes it. If it's good, someone will like it.
Yes. It's like, what you're saying, if make a show that you want to make because they're going to cancel it anyway?
Do, but in the end, they're going to cancel you anyway.
Right.
That's the best advice I ever got.
Right.
Because it applies to life. Applies to life, too. Right?
Live the life that you want to live?
Yeah, because we all get canceled one day. Right?
Well, I'm gonna let you go about your life, and you're an amazing interview. You're everything Steve Cooper said about you was true.
Thanks. It was a pleasure talking to you.
I really it was awesome for you to give me this much time. I appreciate it, and hopefully I'm gonna be in LA in June trying to sell a sitcom because I just did a 1-hour special. And I did a web series, and my manager's kind of cutting them both together and trying to set meetings for the beginning of June. And I want to meet you for lunch at this taco place.
We can make it happen.
Can we make that happen? That'd be funny if I text you. You're like, I was kidding. Go fuck yourself. I don't like you.
I wouldn't be that way. I look forward to lunch.
All right,
I'll talk to you later.
Good all right, Phil, I really appreciate it, man. And good luck.
Okay,
good luck
take
with
care.
Good luck with season two.
Thank you.
All right, take it easy.
Bye.
Bye. Really fast plugs here at the end. If you could donate to the free podcast that I do every week, upped it to 2 episodes a week. I think I'm going to keep it at that. I like them coming out on Tuesdays and Thursdays every week. So go to joematarese.com. You can be a one-time donator, and then right next to that, you could also become a monthly donator with the Patreon app that's there. Well, it's not really an app. It's like a website. You go on it, and there's all different levels of being a monthly donator. Different free things that you get at every level. Go check it out. All you have to do, go to joematarese.com and just click on that Patreon banner right on my homepage. You can't miss it. And I can't forget my donators on Patreon. I always do a little shout out to them. Larry May, thank you again. Love you, Larry May. Jason Abram, you're the best. Robin Kulwicki. Ronald G. Poliquin, thanks. Carlo Valente, you're the man. Bobby Morris, who I used to call Bobby Mama Lukes. Thanks, guys, for donating this month. I really appreciate that. Hope we can build this. That's all I got right now. Can you believe it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 people that are making monthly donations. I got to get that higher. All right? Go to joematarese.com and click on the Patreon logo right there. And I'll hook you up with tons of free stuff. It'll be fun. It'll be worth it. You'll be glad you did it. You'll feel good about yourself. Or if you want to just do the one-time donation, that's there too. Okay? I appreciate you guys. The other thing is, if you want me to come to your town, you want me to do a show, you've heard me talk about this about the last month now, I would love it if you guys would want to do this. It's been working. I have like 3 of them booked so far. I come to your city, you're the producer, you find the venue, we put on a show. It's pretty easy. It's going to all be mapped out on joematarese.com. It's really simple. Email me, matarese67@gmail.com. Okay? I love you guys. Okay? That was a fun episode, right? You feel pretty positive after hearing Phil Rosenthal talk, and he's just such a great positive guy who I idolize a little bit. I'll be honest, he got to do his dream. I'm still nipping it. I'm not there yet. I want to be there. So keep coming back, though. Keep listening to the podcast, and I love my wife, I love my kids, and tell everybody about the new improved Fixed Joe. Did you see the new artwork? I think you did. So tell everybody, spread the word. Love you guys. Talk to you next week.